Ephesians, the fourth chapter. Ephesians chapter 4, verses 4 through 6. Ephesians chapter 4, verses 4 through 6. When you have it, just say amen.
Amen.
Let's read this together. The Bible, the Word of God reads, "There is one body and one spirit, even as you are called in one hope, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God, Father of all, who is above all and through all." If you would repeat after me, the seven wonders of the world. By the name of my neighbor, say neighbor. God has seven wonders of the world. Now shake somebody's hand on nearby and tell them it's good to see you in the house of the Lord. state it again earlier. I'm going to state it again. If you don't know who God is, then you need to just think about how you woke up this morning. And if you're thankful to be alive, you ought to have praise on your lips. Everything that has breath ought to praise the Lord. There is a word from the Word. The seven wonders of the world. Now, I am familiar with man's seven wonders. When you think about wonders, man spelled his seven wonders W-O-N-D-E-R-S. And it simply bears reference to the fact of the great engineering feats of man and what he has been able to accomplish through way of engineering and manufacturing. And we're speaking of the seven wonders. You need to understand that the Great Wall of China is considered one of the great seven wonders of the world. And the pyramids in Africa and the Great Pyramid considered one of the seven wonders of the world. And the Colosseum in Rome considered one of the seven wonders of the world. But now, that's what man has done. And every year, millions of visitors go in different places and they see the seven wonders of the world. They go and they visit. They take friends and they take their family. And they snap pictures in front of the seven wonders of the world. And man is impressed with what he has been able to accomplish. And we lift the engineers up highly because of the great engineering obstacles and the great engineering challenges that they face when making sure that these particular structures were made sound. But I've come today to encourage the family here that there are seven wonders that God has instituted. And these wonders are not spelled W-O-N-D-E-R-S, but these are seven wonders. That's O-N-E. Amen. Somebody help me here. D-E-R-S. There are seven wonders, and these wonders are found in Ephesians, the fourth chapter. So let's stay in Ephesians, the fourth chapter. Paul is telling us that God has done some great things. And by the way, family, anything that God does is great. I say anything that God does is great. God made man, and man is a great model of God's ingenuity. Man not only was made, but the world, the earth, was made. The heavens and the earth were made, and God did it right the first time. And there's enough space. There's enough acreage here in on our earth, that man can migrate and go from this place and that place, and there's still forestry and wilderness. Because God did it right the first time. I come today to encourage somebody to know that God does it right, y'all, the first time. And when God does something, he makes sure that it is a testimony of his great power and of his great might. Now, Paul says to us that there are seven wonders in Ephesians, the fourth chapter, and verse number 4. He starts off by saying there is, say it with us, one body, and one
spirit,
even as you are called into what? One hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, and one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is what? Above all, through all. And if you were counting, that's seven wands. You know, it's interesting to see how man copies from God. I say man copies from God. There were seven wands in the Bible well before man came up with his seven wonders of the world. Y'all might as well say amen. You see, man understands that God gets it right the first time. And so when we speak of seven wonders of the world, talking about mankind, when we reference mankind, we need to know that they didn't do anything but take from what God already established. Because in his word, he has seven wonders. Seven wonders. Now I want to look at these wonders, and hopefully when we leave here, we can leave with an even greater appreciation of what God has been able to do in the lives of men. And not only that, I hope that someone will see that these seven wonders that God performed are wonders that will never pass away. All of the wonders that man constructs are prone to decay, are prone to destruction, are prone to war. But the seven wonders that God makes are seven wonders that will stand the test of time. Now, when you go to the book, it begins by saying that there is what? One power. Now, if you're taking notes, we need to understand that when the apostolic writers spoke of those who came by faith and obeyed the gospel of Jesus Christ and were added to the Lord's church, we need to know that there is reference to the church being called the body. So when Paul says that there is one body, he's speaking of the called out, the church, the ecclesia, those who make up the assembly of the faithful. And he says that there is one body. Now, if I have time, I'd go to Ephesians, the first chapter. You don't have to turn there, but Ephesians, the first chapter, around verses 18 through 22, and tell you that the one body, according to Paul, he already said, is the church. Now, what I want to press is that the one body is important because we have in the one body organization. I said organization. So when Paul speaks of body, he's speaking of an organism. Amen. Which is the church. An organism is a living thing. And the church lives. The church is not dead. I said the church lives. I said the church is not dead. I said the church lives. Y'all not hear me? And the church is not dead. So the church is the body. And the body is the church. And it is an organism. And it represents organization. How do you know this, brother preacher? Get for me 1 Corinthians chapter 12. 1 Corinthians chapter 12. And let's look at verse number 12. 1 Corinthians chapter 12. And let's look at verse number 12. And let's do some reading. The Bible, the word of God says what? For the body is one. Now watch it. Paul says, for as the body is one.
And has many members.
And has what?
Many members.
Many members. Go ahead and read it.
And all the members of that one body.
And all the members of that one body.
Being many.
Being many.
Are one body.
Are one body. Go ahead and read it.
So also is Christ.
Now watch it. So also is Christ.
For by one spirit.
For by one spirit.
Are we all baptized into one
are
body.
Are we all baptized into. One somebody body. Say one body. One Paul body. Says there's but one body. And this one body is the church. Those who believe in Christ Jesus, those who have heard the gospel and have obeyed the gospel and have submitted themselves according to the Bible commandments have been added to the Lord's church. One body. And this one body is the organism. It is the living property of God. And it's also representative of the organization. So when I see the first wonder of the world,
yes,
according to what God has done, I see one body, and the body equals the organization. But not only that, in Ephesians 4:4, I see another one. There's one body, but then the text says there is one spirit. One spirit. Now, body is organized. And spirit is demonstration. a word whereby I can see the good in this organization, for we all have the same spirit of Christ. Same spirit of Christ. And whenever somebody has the spirit of Christ, they don't have to convince you that they are a Christian. Their words, Heavenly Holy Ghost, their deeds, their actions, the way that they move, the way that they carry themselves, it is demonstrative. You know that they are of the spirit of Christ. Body, organization, spirit, demonstration. But it didn't stop that day. Keep reading Ephesians 4. Verse number 4 or 5. What does it say?
Verse number 5.
One Lord. Now here it is. One Lord.
One faith.
One faith.
One baptism.
One baptism.
One God and Father of all.
One God and Father of all.
Who is above all.
Who is above all.
And through all.
Through all.
And in you all.
Now, the Bible says, Paul says there is one Lord. Now, if I had time, I'd go to John, the 14th chapter, and we could check this out. Verse number 6, Jesus says, I am the way.
Yes, sir.
Amen, somebody.
Yes, sir.
He says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father. Now, we have body. Well, that's organization. We have spirit. Well, now, that's demonstration. And now we have one Lord. That's salvation. Salvation. If you're going to be saved, family, you've got to come by one Lord. Not a bunch of lords, not a bunch of places, but you have to come by the place and the designation of Jesus Christ. Jesus says, if you want to gain access to the Father, you must come by me. That bears reference to the fact there's only but one Lord. There's only but one way. There's only but one direction, and that direction, if it doesn't lead you to Christ, then it's not the direction you want to travel. Bible says that there's one Lord. I believe there's one Lord. I believe it because the scriptures verify that God sent his Son. He sent his only begotten Son. And his Son died and shed his blood so that the whole world might be saved. So I have body organization. I have unity, which is demonstration. And now I have Lord, which is salvation. But go back to the text, because that's not the last one. That's three. The Bible says what?
One God, Father of all, who above all, and through
all. One Lord, one what?
One
faith.
One
now, you need to write faith down, because faith is important. Faith is important. Now, faith is your foundation. I say faith is your foundation. Hebrews 11 and verse number 6. But without faith, it is, and you see, you can't even come to God if you don't have anything to stand on. I say you can't come to God. If you stumble at faith, you'll never experience the powerful and the bountiful blessings of God, for faith is your foundation. And without faith, it's like walking all over ledge and not having anything under to support you. You're going straight down. Without faith, you're going down. I can see this play out even in my physical life. When difficult times come, family, I must admit to you, it's my faith that carries me through. You see, when I have counted up the cost, and I know that A and B are supposed to take me to C, and then I get over there to C, and then there's nothing, I say there's nothing underneath. I can't see anything, I'm not hearing anything, no one's telling me anything, and how am I going to make it when I step off and there's no ground under me? Now someone says, I don't know what you mean. Yeah, you know what I mean. Having no ground under you is when you walk into your job and they tell you your services are no longer needed. having no problem under you is when you get home and you find out that your wife or your husband has left you and they're not coming back. Having no problem under you is when you know that you have family and friends who don't know Jesus in the parking of their sin. Having no problem under you is when you lose someone who meant so much to you. Your loved one, your mother, your father, your sister, your brother, your child. How in the world are you going to keep moving? You're going to keep moving by your faith. This is why you want to say, faith is the substance. Y'all better pray with me. Faith is the substance. Substance. It's on an undergirds you. It's the thing that's under you that can't be seen physically, but spiritually, you know it's there. You know it's there. And when you don't expect things to happen the way that they happen, brother, the only thing that's going to get you through a time like that is you got to have a faith that serves as your foundation. I say when the doctor tells you you don't have but so much longer, you need to have a faith to say, I know that the doctors can treat, but praise God, I serve a God who can heal. And if he wants to give me more years, he'll give them to me. Faith is foundation. Foundation. Am I right about it? One Lord, one faith. Now here we are. We have no one baptism. We have no one baptism. Now, baptism. Get for me Colossians 2. And verse number 12. Colossians 2. And verse number 12. And then get for me. We're going to come back and get home. Amen, somebody. I don't want to leave hope out of here. Amen. You try to live your life without hope. Oh, you know, that's a whole other sermon right there. But you know that the truth is coming. All right, now. Go ahead and read. Titus, are you there? Colossians 2. Verse number 12. The Bible says what?
Buried with him in baptism.
Baptism now.
Buried with him in baptism. Where also ye are risen with him.
Where also you are risen with him.
Through the faith of the operation of God.
Through the faith of the operation of God. Now, baptism is designation. Designation. You see, those who are in a particular place for a particular reason, at the particular time, I've been designated among God's saved, among God's faithful. But how did I get the stamp of designation? I got it by baptism. If I want to be saved, I've got to be baptized. If I want to be saved, I must be baptized. How do you know it, preacher? Mark 16. Verse 16, Jesus says, he that believeth and is what? Baptized shall be what? So if I want to be saved, I've got to do what God has assigned. God assigned baptism to the plan. If I want to be added to the church, I cannot be added to the church by giving my Christian experience. That's not in the Bible. I must be added to the church according to what the Bible teaches, and the Bible teaches baptism for the remission of sin. I have to be baptized. That's the designation. But not only must I be baptized, but I need to have some hope. Y'all with me? Titus 1. Verses 1 and 2. I need to have some hope now. Now, what are we hoping for? What does hope look like? Read, the Bible says what?
Paul, a servant of God.
Paul, a servant of God.
And an apostle of Jesus Christ.
And an apostle of Jesus Christ.
According to the faith of God's elect.
According to the faith of God's elect.
And the acknowledgement of truth.
And the acknowledgement of truth.
Which is after God.
Go ahead and read.
In hope of eternal life.
Watch it now. In hope
of eternal life.
In hope of
money.
We're not waiting on them.
Touch your neighbor and say, we're not waiting anymore.
We're not waiting on.
We are living in him.
Yes,
as we were in worship last Sunday, and we spoke from the subject, Seconds from Destruction. While I was preaching, while we were in worship, another tragedy happened. Another tragedy. Listen, my friends, it does not make sense for us to know that all of these things are happening, for perilous times to be in our future on today, and then we still don't move and say, I'm ready to be a Christian. What else is it going to take for God to show us? It won't be long. It won't be long. And listen, my friends, when I think about the fact that Jesus is coming back, I want to see his faith in peace. Because when he left him the first time, he had to stand in another man's court. But when he comes back the second time, all men will stand in his court. And I want Jesus to be my advocate. I want Jesus to be my attorney. I want Jesus to be my legal representation. And the only way I can get Jesus to represent me, the question is, am I representing him? By the blood of Jesus, I'm a joint heir with him. I'm a son of the Most High God. By the blood of Jesus, I'm a royal priesthood. By the blood of Jesus, I have eternal life. By the blood of Jesus, no man can take it from me. By the blood of Jesus, I have hope. By the blood of Jesus, I have faith. By the blood of Jesus, I have the Spirit. By the blood of Jesus, I have baptism. By the blood of Jesus, I am baptized into one body. Am I right about it? By the blood of Jesus, I'm looking forward to going to one place. By the blood of Jesus, I'm able to have my sins forgiven and blotted out until forever and ever. I know I can be saved as long as I come by the blood. But in order to come by the blood, you've got to get past the sinner one first. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, there's one body, there's one Spirit, and we are called into one hope of your calling. I know that when I come by the Bible way, when I come by God's seven wonders, I'm in the church showing up. And I'm just coming today to encourage somebody that if you're not in the family of God, you need to be in the family of God. God has given seven wonders of the world. And if you're going to observe any seven wonders, make sure it's the wonders of God. Amen. Stand to your feet, wherever you are. Stand to your feet. And we pray that someone will be saved. We pray that someone will say, I'm ready. Put Christ on in baptism. I'm ready because you have proved it to me by going through the book, the chapter, and the verse. So I know that you didn't preach it your way. I read it for myself, and I'm ready. I don't need anybody to hold me back any longer. I'm not going to let the devil to cloud my mind any further. I'm ready to be saved. I want to be a Christian. You can be a Christian right now. You can do it right now. You can leave here rejoicing. You'll be added to the Lord's church. You've heard the gospel. You need to believe it with all of your heart. Repent of all of your sins. Confess his name before me. Go down in faith in the water and bring of baptism, having repented of your sins. When you call upon the name of the Lord through obedience of baptism, you can be saved. If you're already a member of the body of Christ and you have wandered off and you need to rededicate your life, you need to pray for forgiveness of sin, whatever you need, whatever you're going through, you're facing sometimes a difficult, whatever it is. Don't leave here without being on the Lord's side. If you come, we want you to know that when you come, you're not coming to man. You're coming to God. And the same God who made you is the same God who will save you.
Will you come as the brother who sings this song?
There are some things
of the Lord.
I may not know. Him in my soul.